We'd love that opportunity to get to know you a little better and why you're here. I want to ask you a question this morning. What is Christmas? When you think of Christmas, what images come to your mind? What memories come of Christmas past, of families that gather together? For me, it is a time of family. It's a time when family does come. I don't get to see my family very often. They live a ways away. They live even further away now than they used to. They're busy. They've got lots of grandkids, and they've got lots of kids of their own. We've got lots of aunts and uncles doing lots of things, so we don't get to get together very often. But Christmas is one of those times that we are always all together. And I remember times in the past. I remember seeing people and friends and family that I haven't seen for a long time. It's Christmas, a time of generosity. Maybe you're like me. I'm a shopper. I admit it now to you today. I'm a shopper. I don't like crowds at all. But this time of year is the one time that I can endure the crowds. Because I like to go on the quest for that perfect gift, preferably a bargain, right? But going and finding something on a shelf and going, man, that reminds me of my brother. That would be perfect for him. That reminds me of my sister. That makes me think of my mother. It's nothing big, but it's a quest. It's a search, and I enjoy it. And there is some sense of accomplishment when it's in your hand, until you look at the line, right, and realize now comes the hard part of shopping, the waiting in lines. Dustin turned 13 yesterday, and we took him out to eat for his birthday. He wanted to go bowling, so we stopped over there and went bowling. And I had to run into Dick's Sporting Goods to get something completely un-Christmas related. And because it was un-Christmas related, I decided that it could wait. Because I walked in and I remembered, oh yeah, it's December 22nd. Christmas Eve is Monday. And here are all these last-minute shoppers. And the line went, it was like Black Friday. The line went from the registers all the way down to the end and towards the back of the store. And what I needed was about $4. And I decided that it just wasn't worth it. And you see that everywhere you go right now, there's this immediate realization of, oh no, it's here. And I have some preparing to do. Maybe that's where you are. And maybe that's what Christmas is to you. It's the rushing around at the end. And maybe that's the thrill that you get from this season. It's trying to pick everything up on the last day, hoping the shelves aren't dry, and hoping that you don't spend all of your time waiting in lines, in the pursuit of the short line at the checkout register. You know, I can recall the anticipation, though, as a child, when all the gifts were packaged and laid under the tree. And my mom was the softie, and we'd go to her and say, hey, Mom, how about one gift tonight? Dad won't let you. But Dad might let you. And could you just talk to Dad tonight, please? Maybe we could just open one. I mean, there's like six or seven under there. So if we open one tonight, that's not going to make Christmas Eve that much less great. And maybe then if we could open one tonight and one tomorrow night, and when Mom and Dad are out of the room, you pick it up and you give it a little shake, right? What could this be? Is it soft? Is it pliable? Is it hard? Does it rattle? What did I ask for? I asked for a lot of things. I wonder what this could be. But there was this anticipation, this excitement that would build day after day as December 24th approached. And I see the anticipation now in my own kids. One of my favorite Christmas stories, you'll probably recognize this line. Well, you will, because the name is in the very front of it. And the Grinch, with his Grinch feet ice cold in the snow, stood puzzling and puzzling. How could it be so? It came without ribbons, it came without tags, it came without packages, boxes, or bags. And he puzzled 3 hours till his puzzler was sore. Then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more. You see, this season has taken on a much more meaningful tone since my own children came along. I remember the moments that surrounded their births, the trips to the hospital, the family that came to visit, the first time the doctor handed me each of them and said, "Would you like to hold your son or your daughter?" I remember the blanket they were wrapped in. I remember how tiny they were. I remember the fear. And then Christmas became more of this time of family. There was a search that there had to be something more. A desire to keep them away from all that our culture asks of us and ingrains in us, and the selfishness and the materialism and the greed and the "I want, I want, I want." Make a Christmas list. Make a wish list. And those birth stories are amazing to me. They changed my world. They changed the way that I see everything around me and everything about my existence. But Christmas perhaps means a little bit more. Christmas for us as Christians is a time when we remember. The pomp and circumstance around this season serve as a reminder of the birth that changed the world in every way imaginable. So I ask again, what is Christmas? At a moment in time when so many across this country and so many across the world are going to stop and peer into a manger, they're going to stop and look at the Messiah. What is it that we want them to know about Jesus? Is our fervor as Christians about Christmas over gifts and boxes and paper and food? Or do we truly celebrate a birth that transformed the human condition? I want to look at five observations about a story that we've all seen and read and talked about, and we see it everywhere. And I'm not going to reinvent the wheel here. I'm not going to shatter your world. I'm not going to tell you anything that we don't know, but I want to take a moment today and refocus what Christmas is to you and I as Christians. It is not something that we celebrate once a year. It is something that changes who we are because of what Jesus Christ did for us when he came down to this earth. And the first one is, do you understand how far the Almighty God has come for you? Do you understand how far the Almighty God has come for you? Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 33. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High God. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. And his kingdom will never end." God Almighty came down from heaven. Jesus, our Savior, our Redeemer, left his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. And he came down to this earth so that you and I might have hope for eternity with him. Do you understand how far the Almighty God has come for you? Think of the distances that will be traveled over this season. Think of how far you will go or how far your friends will come or your family will come simply to be with the ones that they love. The vast expanses that are covered, the lengths that are gone to all be in the company of the people that we love. We juggle schedules. We start early. My sister will call me, "What's your plan for Christmas?" It's like, "I don't know. It's June." She goes, "Yeah, I know, but we got to get Thanksgiving plans and Christmas plans, and we want to find out when we're going to go to Jacksboro and when they're going to go to Houston and when my brother's going to go up to Dallas and when they're going to go out to Corpus." But they want to rearrange those schedules to make sure that when we come to town, they're all there. We go to great lengths to be with the people that we love. Some of our family we don't even like. But you get the dread. Oh, man, there's Aunt Sally. "Hey, we're so glad you're here. Come on in. We've got a bed made for you. We just want them to feel at home, even the ones that we don't like, because they are family." And it is what we do in those times. We go out of our way. We put things that have been important to us all year long on the back burner simply to be with the ones that we love. How come so often when Jesus comes and knocks on our door, we don't have that same excitement to let Him in? Why do we open the door and go, "Oh, it's Jesus. I've got some things I've got left to do," and just close the door again? We don't invite Him in. We don't make Him feel at home. We don't allow Him to really, truly be a part of who we are. He has traveled a long way for you. He has come so far for you. He came down from heaven so that we might have a hope for eternity with Him. The second observation I want to make today is that His birth should drive us to praise and worship the Father. The birth of Jesus Christ should drive you and I to praise and worship of our Father. Luke chapter 1 and verse 46. We don't have this song in our books yet. I'm going to trust that it's coming in some of our coming addendums. I hope that it is. The song is Magnificat. And it is this song that Mary sings in four parts. And it is one of my favorite songs of all time. And I want you to listen to what Mary says when she discovers that she has been conceived with the Son of God. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for He has been mindful of the humble state of His servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me." Holy is His name. His mercy extends to those who fear Him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with His arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He's helped His servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as He promised our ancestors. You see, Mary is overwhelmed with the thought that the Messiah and the Savior was coming to the world through her. There are many things that go through my head as a father. There are many anxieties. There are many concerns. There are many things that I look at and go, "Man, how in the world am I supposed to deal with this?" I get concerned about the decisions they're going to make when they go to school. I get very concerned about the decisions they're going to make when they grow up and leave my house. There's all kinds of things. And I wonder, am I going to do a good enough job as a father to prepare them for that? I can't imagine what was really going through Mary's head as she begins to look at the task that is laid in front of her of raising the Son of God. I wonder how my perspective might have been changed had I been in Joseph's shoes. What if our first response at all of these things was just to simply praise God? As I mentioned before, who knows what was actually going through Mary's heart. But her choice in a very uncertain time was to just put away all the uncertainty and to praise God and to worship God and to glorify the Lord. The birth of Jesus Christ should drive us to the same level of praise and worship that Mary did. The third observation I want to make today is that we must understand the impact of a Savior, of an advocate, of one who intercedes to the Father on our behalf, who knows what we face. That's a pretty jam-packed observation, but I didn't really want to have eight observations for you today, so this one is full. To understand a Savior, to understand an advocate, one that stands between you and I and the King and intercedes on our behalf. Not as one who stands from far away and says, yeah, they're good, but as one who says, look, I know what they've been through. I know the trouble that they face on a daily basis. I know the struggle that it is to be human. I know the struggle that it is to be holy and be human. And I've paid the price. One who intercedes for us on our behalf that knows what we face each day. Luke chapter 2 and verse 4. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. John chapter 1 and verse 14, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. He became human. The Son of God put on this old human body, chose to walk in the places that we walk, chose to experience the things that we experience, chose to be tempted the way that we are tempted, chose to hurt the way we hurt, cry the way we cry, and laugh the way we laugh. He became human for you and for me. Philippians 2, verse 5 through 11, one of my favorite passages of Scripture. And your relationships with one another have the same mindset as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. And rather, he made himself nothing. And by taking the very nature of a servant, and being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. And therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Immanuel, God with us. Immanuel changes the world. Immanuel changes the world simply by stepping into it. Immanuel changes the way you and I see the world. Immanuel changes the way that we live. Immanuel changes the way that we see other people, but most importantly, brothers and sisters, today, Immanuel changes the way we relate to the King. Immanuel changes the way that we relate to a father. That because of his trip to this earth, because of the life that he lived, because of the life that he gave, we have the opportunity to live in peace in harmony with the one that formed it all. Immanuel changes everything. There is nothing in heaven. There is nothing on earth. There is nothing under the earth that isn't changed because of Immanuel. Because the Word became flesh Because Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was found in appearance as a man. Because he humbled himself and became obedient to death on a cross. Nothing has changed. Everything has changed. Nothing stays the same. And the fourth observation I want to make today is that the glory of the Savior cannot be denied. Luke chapter 2 and verse 8. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over the flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior is born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord, and this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." And when the angels left them and had gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." And so they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. An angelic chorus sings songs of praise. A star is placed in the sky to mark the place where shepherds and wise men would come to see the Savior. I didn't see any of those above the hospital when my children were born. I didn't see an angelic chorus that come down out of the sky. There wasn't a giant star placed over Renaissance and Edmund to guide my in-laws and my mom and dad and all my family to see what I thought was the next best thing. But when Jesus is born, the world can't help but praise. An angelic chorus sings praises to God. And when the shepherds see the baby, they can't keep it in. They're like, "We got to tell people. We have seen the Lord. We've seen the Messiah. It has come. The angels came down. The star was there. This is what we've been waiting for." And they go around and they tell people. They traveled great distances when the angel told them what had occurred. And I want to ask you, how easy do you find it to keep Jesus to yourself? How easy do you find it to kind of just keep it close by and maybe do the easy and the less objected way? You're saying, "Well, I know what Jesus is. I know what he offers for me. I know what he gives the church. But I'm just going to live my life." See, the shepherds met the Lord and they couldn't help but run and tell everybody that they saw. And I can't help but think that's what we are supposed to do as well. When we realize what Jesus has to offer, not just you and I, but to everyone who will come. How do we keep it to ourselves? How do we keep from running out and telling everybody that we see about the Savior that we have? And the fifth observation here is that the Christ child is something to be treasured. Luke chapter 2 and verse 19, "But Mary treasured up all of these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told." I remember the day my children were born. But the moment that it became a reality was when the nurse came in and said, "Mr. Fowler, do you have a car seat in your car?" I was like, "Yeah, there's been a car seat in my car for weeks." It's like, "Why don't you go and get it?" "What for?" "It goes in the car." It's like, "It's time for you to go home." What am I supposed to do at home? Right? Because for right now, if something's not working right, I can just go, "Hey, nurse, I need your help. You're not coming with me, are you?" All right, this immediate sense of responsibility. This immediate sense of what in the world have I gotten myself into? This immediate sense of I'm up a creek without a paddle because I don't have the first clue what to do. when she said, "It's time for you to go home." It was daunting. I can't imagine what it must have been like for Mary. I can't imagine what it must have been like for Joseph. The responsibility that they must have felt to have found favor with God in such a way that He entrusted His Son to them. We should treasure the birth of Christ and all that it means for us as Christians. And so I want to ask you again, what is Christmas to you? I encourage you to take this time of the year and all the emotions and joy that it can bring and focus those thoughts on the true meaning of the event that we commemorate, the event that we celebrate. But I also want you to know that I know that this time is not a happy time of year for everyone. And maybe it's not a happy time of year for you. Maybe because of loss, or because of a struggle in your family, or because of illness, or whatever the reason. This may not be what stirs up in you when Christmas time comes around. But the joy in this time for you is that you don't make that trek alone. None of us go through these things alone. The King sent His Son to live where you live. The King sent His Son to hurt where you hurt. And the King sent His Son to laugh where you laugh and to cry where you cry. And this is what Christmas is about for those who will call on the name of the Lord. This is what Christmas is about for those who have chosen to walk in the grace of the plan to save mankind that began long, long ago, but was really kicked into high speed when Jesus Christ was born. If you have not yet taken the opportunity to live in that grace, there's no time like now to make that decision. Maybe you have made the decision to live in that grace a long time ago, but you need the help of the church to get back into the grace that you know you should be living with. If there is anything at all that the church can do for you, or if you would like to be clothed in Jesus Christ in baptism, you can come forward here this morning as we stand and as we sing.
Hey, dear brother, oh, why do you tarry so long? Your Savior is waiting to give you a place in His sanctified throng. Why not, why not, why not come to Him now? Why not, why not, why not come to Him now? What do you hope, dear brother?